Hey, hey, I'm Shay Warner, and you are listening to Casual Cattle Conversations. If you are ready to explore different management practices and focus on improving your operation and the beef industry, this is the podcast for you. Welcome to the show. I'm so excited you are listening. Alrighty, folks, it is Shay here, and thank you for tuning in to this podcast. So with the challenges we are facing as cattle producers today, there is this continued push towards increased efficiency and management in cattle performance to drive profitability. This podcast episode is going to be a conversation between myself and three other individuals to discuss how cattle producers can start making more informed management decisions and gain more insight about their herd's forage intake and efficiency of each individual animal. So you are going to hear from David Smith, the founder of Ceres Tag, Dr. Troy Rowan, who is the assistant professor and extension specialist at the University of Tennessee's Department of Animal Science, along with Barbara Jackson, who is the owner of Animal Health Express. So this conversation is going to provide insight on the importance of knowing the forage intake of your herd, how to measure it, and how to make decisions based on this information to increase your profitability as a cattle producer. Folks, we are really going to dive into some good stuff here. But before we do that, I do want to let you know that I am opening up limited spots in my Rancher Mind membership in the coming months to allow a few of you to join us. So Rancher Minds is a small group of 10 to 20 ranchers who meet once a month with industry experts and one another to have constructive conversations about the management topics that matter most to you as cattle producers and how to find and create solutions for these challenges. So you can learn more by heading to my website in the show notes and sending me a message once you get on there. So with that, let's visit with David, Troy, and Barbara. All right. Well, David, Troy, and Barbara, it is an absolute pleasure to have you here with me today. Well, not physically here. Maybe someday it'd be great to visit with all of you in person. But I'm really excited about the topic of this conversation and really what we get to discuss and share with cattle producers today. But before we dive into that, I would like each of you to introduce yourself, talk about where you're located and, you know, really why you're a part of this conversation today when we talk about the importance of managing and measuring forage intake in the cattle industry and helping cattle producers make more informed management decisions. So with that, to start off, David, how about we start with you?
Well, thanks very much, Shay. It's a pleasure to be on your program again. My name is David Smith, and I'm the CEO and co-founder of Ceres Tag. We've been going now since 2016. We spent 5 years in R&D and efficacy testing to make the world's first direct-to-satellite livestock monitoring platform. We came to market in May 2021, and we're now operating in 36 countries. The reason why we're passionate about this industry is, and the way we do things is, we don't require any infrastructure. It's a plug-and-play system. And we wanted to improve the productivity and profitability of ranchers right around the world. And we're currently in growing at a very good rate. Thanks very much.
Well, happy to visit with you and have you here on the show today. Troy, how about yourself?
Yeah, thanks. Thanks again, Shay, for having us. My name is Troy Rowan. I'm an assistant professor and an extension specialist at the University of Tennessee in Knoxville. I guess my interest in forage-based efficiency comes a little bit more on the genetic side of things. I'm a trained geneticist and an animal breeder, and so I'm always thinking about ways to measure economically important traits. And in our part of the world where forage is our greatest resource, we're a very cow-calf driven state, finding ways for producers to make selection decisions that allow them to maximize their forage resources is something that's always at the front of my mind. So I'm very interested in this conversation around holistic cow efficiency and in strategies that we can use from the genetic side of things to help it advance that and improve it across the industry.
Well, thank you. And last but certainly not least, Barbara.
Hello. Again, thank you for including me. I'm Barbara Jackson, and I'm based in Tucson, Arizona. And I have been in the cattle business all my life. I grew up in the feed yard business, but I've been in the animal health supply business for a lot of years. And anytime there's new technology that can help livestock producers do a better job, have more information, more profitability, I'm all about it. And measuring pasture intake is something that I don't think has been done in any reliable way. And so that really caught my attention. And where we're in the West and we run on, unlike Troy there, we run on huge acreage to get that blade of grass for our poor little cows. You know, this is exciting. So that's what I'm here for, is if we've got some technology to get the word out.
So Barbara, when you think about your role working with those cow-calf producers, and what are some of the main challenges you are seeing them face that makes you so excited about this technology? You just touched about it a little bit, but as you're kind of hands-on with these people, what are some of those main challenges you see?
Well, in the West, we run on a lot of public lands, and so they very much dictate how many animals you can run. And so if we can have information that shows especially the GPS part, where we go in the pasture, you know, and we're only using this part of the pasture, and with different management techniques, we can use another part of the pasture, the public lands, and not overgraze or anything. That's one aspect. So the GPS equally to the pasture intake is exciting for us, you know, so because that's always a difficulty is where are they and what part. I mean, you can tell by what's been grazed, you know, but still. So that both aspects of it, the GPS and the pasture intake, are exciting to us.
Absolutely. So Troy, kind of a question for you. You know, you talked about forage being a great resource, especially where you're at in Tennessee, and forage is a very valuable and necessary resource for anyone who's raising cattle, specifically cow-calf producers. Why, you know, can you touch a little bit more on why you see it being so important for cow-calf producers to have an understanding of how much forage their cattle are consuming?
Yeah, that's a great question. And something that whenever I'm talking about cow efficiency and forage resources, I think it takes a little bit of a reframing of how we maybe have thought about this historically. I was a 100 cow operation or 150 cow operation or 1,000 cow operation. But it's not the number of cows that's the limiting resource to a cow-calf operation in particular, right? It's that forage resource, how it's managed and what cows you put on there is going to dictate what your carrying capacity is from a number of head standpoint. So I'm really working in my extension life to try and get producers to reframe that a little bit, maybe think about what's the actual carrying capacity of this forage base. Does shrinking my cow size a little bit more help me carry more cows and not sacrifice that much on my end product, whether that's weaning weight, whether that's red meat at the end of the day? So again, I think it's all about trying to maximize those resources, do more with less, right? We talk all about efficiency. But again, I think we have to scale it by how many acres of forage we have. So an understanding of how individual animals are using that forage base is really invaluable to quantifying how effective an operation is, and its overall profitability at the end of the day is going to be dictated on how efficiently those cows can turn forage into wean calf.
And so I appreciate you bringing up that it's about profitability, because that's something that I really want. Well, that's a key theme in a lot of my episodes. That's something a lot of my listeners and most cow-calf producers, as they're pushing towards them managing more with a business mindset, profit is important, especially for those, you know, well, anyone, but those family operations who are looking at continuing a legacy and everything along those lines. So Troy, I'd be curious in hearing a little bit more about kind of your research with Ceres Tag and how cattle producers can manage forage intake, whether, you know, how was that tried, how did we try to manage or measure that in the past, and how can we measure it now with technology, just so those the audience out there kind of gets an idea of where we were at with how to measure forage intake and where we're headed in the future.
Yeah, so I guess as a younger researcher in this world, all the easy traits to measure have been measured out the wazoo, right? We've got lots and lots of birth weight records and weaning weight records, and I'm getting more and more carcass records, of course. And that's the foundation on which we build all of our genetic predictions. I'm a big believer, obviously, in EPDs and using those in sire selection. That's made an incredible amount of progress in our industry. So what I'm left with is somebody who's just come onto the scene is figuring out how do we go out and measure these traits that have traditionally been really, really hard to measure, especially the ones that are the most economically important. And once we move past things like fertility, another thing that my lab works on in a big way, the next most important thing, once you've got a cow and she gets pregnant, is understanding how effectively she uses her resources and diverts that into pounds that you can sell at the end of the year. So my research program is really focused on finding novel measures, ways that we can measure feed intake effectively on forage in a cost-effective manner. So I've talked about this with both David and Barbara before, but the thing that I really think we have to wrap our minds around is that it's not just as simple as putting forage in front of an animal and asking how much of it disappears, right? So the grow safe systems, they're Vitelli systems now, feed intake is something that we've measured a lot more of those phenotypes, and our selection tools as a result have gotten more and more accurate as it comes to traits like dry matter intake, because we've measured enough of those records. But the challenge when it comes to that forage-based cow is she's not eating a concentrate diet like we're probably putting in front of her in a grow safe. And there's a whole level of behavior and adaptation that goes into that cow's grazing ability, her ability to, in a stressful environment, maybe go out and forage. And again, that's not picked up when we put even forage in front of her in a feed intake system. So where Ceres Tag comes in, and something that I think even our very, very early stages of looking at data from them, is that the conventional wisdom has been that bigger cows are going to eat more, right? And in general, that's the case. But what Ceres Tag and having an algorithm that predicts that forage-based feed intake allows you to do is look at some of those cows that are outliers, right? That are either eating more or less than what we would expect, just given their body weight. So even on our very first trial, we put 10 Ceres Tags in, a set of younger sort of first calf heifers, and just kind of monitored them over the course of 30 to 60 days, something like that. And it was really surprising to see some of our smaller heifers were actually the ones that were eating more than their contemporaries. A big 1,450 pound heifer, she was actually our lowest consumer of forage based on the Ceres Tag. So again, when it comes to doing genetics and measuring phenotypes that are economically important, the ability to pull out those outliers is very, very, it's sort of at the core of making genetic progress. And so any tool that we can use to help drill into those and identify those animals, particularly if it's something that we can do in a cheap and not labor intensive way, we're always really excited about that. So that's sort of how Ceres Tag has fit in to our research surrounding cow efficiency. But we're simultaneously coming at it from a number of different ways, thinking about strategies for again, finding cheap, easy ways to measure how efficient a cow might be.
So we will dive in a little later, more about all the functions of the tag and more about the tag, but I do have a question. So, and whether that's Troy or David or Barbara who answers this, but, you know, Troy, that was a great description of how that's working in the research scenario, right? So what about when this technology is applied to actual cattle ranches? How are we seeing this help cattle producers make those more informed cattle or more informed decisions, management decisions? How is it, what does it look like in a more real world setting as far as helping cattle producers?
I'll take a a whack at that for just a little bit. You know, David mentioned in the beginning, it's a plug and play deal. And I think that's just critical for the average rancher. You know, again, being in this animal health business for many years, you know, given enough time and money in the lab, you can invent just about anything, but that doesn't mean we can take it out in the field and use it practically for a beneficial purpose. And the fact that this is very user-friendly, you know, it's on a ear tag setup that's been used in the industry already. So a guy knows how to put it in the animal. That's great. And now it's just a learning curve of measuring this technology or this pasture intake and this information. And then how do we make decisions with it? And we need guys like Troy to show us how that's going to be important and what we pull from this information, because it's like a lot of things, it's going to be, you know, it's going to be drinking from the fire hose, kind of all the information that's coming in. So how do we extrapolate it and make informed decisions from it? And that's part of the learning curve and everything. And why I'm glad that Ceres has put these tags with research guys that can help us do this.
Yeah, thanks, Barbara. It's from our perspective, it's all about design. And it's not just design of the technology itself. Everyone gets focused on the technology, what it does and stuff, but the ease of use. And it takes a long time to get that design right and getting feedback and continually improving. And that's what we've been doing for many, many years now, and sort of reason why it's so easy and accessible and can be deployed. I guess for us, for decades, as Troy indicated, for decades, we've been measuring weight gain, milk production, all of the outputs. But for the very first time, we can now measure the inputs. So, you know, you talk about profit. Profit means not just the outputs, what the price you're going to get, but what it costs you. And that's the bit that hasn't been readily available while the animal's grazing. I mean, we've got people like here in Australia, the Australian Brahma Breeders Association, for instance, who are developing pasture-based EBVs on this information. And the feed conversion efficiency on pasture, we're showing that is completely different to what you would think if you were just taking information at the feedlot end. So that's something that, and look, at there are other breeds that are looking to go down this line as well. So overall, we're going to see more profitable producers because they've got the information available to them quite readily that they can make those choices. So, you know, the outliers, getting those outliers out and focusing on the genetics, the phenotypes. I should really be specific about the phenotypes, which leads to that assistance in the genetic selection of the animals.
Yeah, and I think if I can add to what David said there, even from before we get into calculating an EPD or an EBV, a single herd with this information, I think the utility is again a better accounting of what cows are pulling their weight and which ones are maybe a little bit more of a forage sink for you, right? So again, that cow that weans off a heavy calf every year, we've tended to love her. But if we don't have that other side of the accounting, it's really hard for us to say if she's actually a net positive for us, or she might be average or below average when we see how much she eats, right? So any amount of information we can have that scales our productivity by that utilization of our limiting forage is really, really valuable, both at the individual herd level. And then once we extrapolate out into the population, which is very much where I work, we think about what do we do once we've got thousands of these phenotypes. But even on the individual herd level, I think that there's some value in understanding how those animals are using your limited resources.
Absolutely. And so you've already touched on it a couple times, but is there anything else, Troy, you want to add from the standpoint of how this may impact genetic selection in the future, or just selection of cattle? I mean, it's been scattered throughout this conversation, but just as a main question, is there anything else you want to include?
Yeah, I think that when we think about selecting cattle and making selection tools, It's really important to keep in mind that it's a long-term thing, right? Troy doesn't throw these in, 50 cows at his research station, and then come up with an EBV the next day or an EPD, right? This is a long-term gradual thing that just like David said, some folks in Australia, they've had a 5 or so year head start on us in the States in collecting these, in mass. So it really takes, collecting these things at a really big scale for us to get reliable selection tools and lots of refinement there. But once you've got it, I think that I always point my producers towards these economic selection indexes when it comes to making decisions. So these are going to combine multiple traits, weight them by their economic value, and then give you a more holistic picture about the genetic potential for profitability that a particular animal might have. So where this fits in, in the future, when we get some sort of a selection tool for forage-based pasture intake, right? That's a big piece of the profit equation that's missing from our current selection indexes. We downwardly weight mature cow size. We downwardly weight things like maternal milk, right? We know those are very energetically expensive things. So we put some downward selection pressure on both of those. But again, that's not the direct measure of the economically relevant trait. So the ability to plug something like forage-based intake into our selection indexes would be really, really valuable, because once you're doing that, you're a whole lot closer to measuring the true economically relevant trait in the profit equation.
Okay, so can we talk a little bit more about how this tag that is in the ear of cattle is measuring this forage intake?
Sure. The pasture feed intake algorithm specifically was developed over a 15-year period by CSIRO in Australia in various different climatic conditions and on various different breeds of cattle. The algorithm takes into account walking, eating, resting, drinking, and most importantly, ruminating. And it uses those parameters to do the calculations. And it's not just one algorithm, it's a suite of eight different algorithms taking those into consideration. So naturally, if the grass is not as high in energy, for instance, it may need to walk further, it may need to graze more. There's a lot of things that are taken into consideration with this algorithm. So, and it wasn't developed overnight. And it was also matched up with other techniques to measure these pasture feed intakes to be able to come up with something that could be basically plug and play, put on the ear, and very easily applied in a commercial enterprise that could do it. The other thing worth noting is that the ear tags are reusable. So, you may have it on the animal for a period of time and you could then switch it and create that also for another animal. It really depends on how you want to use the data, because the data is used for so many different other applications as well. You can either leave it on the same one or you can move it around as well. The flexibility is it's quite attractive for people to get that information.
Very, very practical, definitely. What other features are available with it? Because I know this was not the first one and not the only one that's out there with this tag. And as Barbara said, there's a lot of information that comes off it. So what else is tied to it?
Well, you got to remember that this was developed in Australia. So Meat and Livestock Australia was a contributor, CSIRO, the Queensland government was also a contributor, because it's, there's 11 million cattle in the state of Queensland. So it's an important economic factor. But we initially developed this for very simple reduction of stock theft, improving traceability, improving that, for those that are into the regenerative side of livestock agriculture, For mortality. So when the death of an animal occurs, we get notified if a predator was to come out and chase the animals. For financing, you know, one of the things that's been brought to my attention is the amount of fraud that's happening in the US in the cattle industry with ghost cattle, you know, that don't really exist. So, you know, having this as the way to provide that testament that they actually exist is critical. And I think there's no more evidence that this is required than in the, what's happened in the US over the last 12 months as well. Unfortunately, it had not been brought to my attention until just recently. So there are, it's not about just what it does, because on board the tag is some machine learning. So we can continually add like sickness algorithms so that we can pick up BRD. You know, that work's currently underway as well. There's the ability to continually improve and add new detection mechanisms, whether it's for health, welfare, behavior, whatever the case may be. Where we are right now with pasture feed intake, we're focusing on, because this is really the exciting bit. And, you know, I think we've heard from Troy and Barbara how applicable this, you know, the impact that we can have to help people right now.
Well, and applicable, but necessary. Like we've talked about, there's been a lot of outputs that have been measured, but the ability to have gain more insight on the inputs, because when we look at the costs for cow-calf producers when they're evaluating their break-evens, feed costs and fuel costs are a huge part of that for so many cow-calf producers, especially those of us who are in the northern part of the states. And are in winter right now. I think you guys are all in a lot nicer climates right now when we're recording this, but I picked where I live and operate. So I do want to shift gears back to the conversation of forage intake, which we've been talking about the whole time, but really, why is this going to be so imperative for future generations? Like when we think about, you know, just the next generations to come, why is it so important that future generations have a good grasp on forage intake of their cattle and measuring that?
So what we're seeing is the next generation of producers coming through have got a completely different mindset. For a start, most of them are well-educated, have been to, you know, university or some sort of other education level. They're digital natives, so they're completely comfortable with data and the way in which data can be used and combined with other information. I mean, this is animal information, but as you know, and you know directly, Shay, it's not just animal information that drives a whole farm operation. It's multiple different things that contribute to your decision-making. But what we're also finding is the shortage of labor is requiring that automation and the ability to use the information to only act on things that need to be acted on, and let the technology do what it does, and to reduce the wasted time that can be the costs, you know, wasted time is a cost, and you want to reduce those things out of your operation as well. So that's what we're seeing. And that's, by the way, that's a global phenomena. Each one of those is not just US or Australia. It is happening everywhere.
Barbara, do you have any thoughts on that, or even just the importance of future generations being able to make more informed management decisions with this data? Or any data?
Yeah, I mean, it's agriculture, the cattle business, cow calf, whatever. I mean, it's a capital intensive industry. And you know, the old saying, if you don't marry it or inherit it, you can't even get into it. So and I think in the last few years, I've seen more new young people come into it as first generation ranchers or farmers or whatever. And I think that's particularly exciting. And these are smart people that they know what their land cost is, they know what their inputs are, they know what everything is. And so this is just, you know, you can't hope it rains and turn some out and see what happens. You know, you've got to know what's going to happen. And you know, they're forward contracting their calves. They got to know what their inputs are and everything. So yeah, the more data, and like I say, the young people are not afraid of it as much as some, maybe the old timers might have been. But so that's, you know, that's just the more they know, the better they can decide and the decisions they can make. And that's critical.
Yeah, if I can add to the thoughts there, I think that in all framing this through Tennessee's point of view, we're in a little bit different scenario maybe than Barbara, right? We're a forage rich environment, but our pressure is coming from more from cities than it is from a lack of resources. So we've lost something like 500,000 acres of agricultural land between 2017 and 2022. So our urban areas are growing so fast. The research farm where we've got Ceres Tag actually about 35 minutes south of Nashville, which is one of the two or three fastest growing metroplexes in the U.S. And I mean, we've got subdivisions on three sides of that research station in a big battery powered Cadillac plant on the other side. And so our pressures, when we think about moving forward, that's not a University of Tennessee specific thing. There's a lot of young cattle producers in the state of Tennessee that are getting really squeezed on their land. So that question of maximizing our outputs with limited inputs becomes even more important. And I think that any tool that we have, whether it's high tech or low tech, that helps us more effectively produce the same amount of beef or more beef with less resources is ultimately what's going to keep folks in the business. And that longevity, that's that element of sustainability in the business, right? How long can we stay in and keep doing this thing that our families have maybe been doing for a long time? This thing maybe that we've just jumped into as young people, whatever that is. I think it all relies on being able to maximize the usefulness of our resources. And again, forage is where it all starts. So as we circle back, I guess, to being able to measure forage-based intake, you can't improve anything that you can't measure. So any tool that gets you a little bit closer there, I think is a huge step in the right direction.
All right. Well, I want to thank the three of you for joining me for this conversation. I think we could go a lot of other directions and talk for hours about this if we really wanted to, but I want to be respectful of everyone's time. So as we kind of wrap up the conversation today, do the three of you have any parting thoughts you'd like to leave this audience with?
Well, I'll start since I did the first introduction. look, the US is really it's a great market, and we're looking forward to being more integrated in it. We're grateful for the partners that are on this call with us, Troy, with the research that he's been doing from a US context as well is really great, and Barbara as our first distributor into the US is great to have that boots on the ground and access for this sort of capability that can improve both the productivity and the profitability of the US rancher.
Troy, Barbara, anything you'd like to add?
No, just as we've said, you know, any new tool that can help us be better informed and make better decisions in our business operations is something you've got to look at and utilize as best you can. And I think that fact that this is user-friendly, easy to use, and I don't think we mentioned it anywhere, but I like the fact that Ceres Tag, you don't have to buy software with it. If you're using a software, it pretty much goes into most common softwares being used in the cattle industry today. And I think that's very nice, very friendly, you know, that they can just go ahead and keep going with what software they're on. And so just another tool in the toolbox. I think it's great.
Yeah. And the last thing that I guess I'd close out with is that I love technology probably as much as anybody in the beef industry, but it's always important. And I'll use this venue to say, Make sure you've got the basics in check too, before we start layering technologies on. So having a grazing management plan is still really, really important. Crossbreeding will increase the efficiency of a cow herd more than anything, right? So there's all these things that we've known for a long time, but a lot of operations are still leaving money on the table. So this technology is awesome, and I'm really excited to see where it takes things. But making sure that you've got a really solid base and foundation, we're doing the things that we've known for a long time, right? That's an essential first step. But a tool like Ceres Tag paired with a herd that's really doing things the right way, I think can go a long ways.
All right. Well, thank you again to all of you for joining me for this conversation and sharing all your knowledge with those cow-calf producers and ag enthusiasts who are listening today.
Thank you. Thank you for including us.
Well, folks, I don't know about you, but I know conversations like that really get me excited when I think about how the beef industry is really trying to push and move forward and come up with solutions to help us as cattle producers measure what matters and use that data in a way that is really going to push our operations forward. So if you have more questions about Ceres Tag or anything that was talked about today, you can reach out to me. But more importantly, I have links to the website for this company, as well as for Animal Health Express. All that's in the show notes per usual. So, but if you have other questions or want any contact information, please reach out to me as well. Happy to help answer questions and guide you in the right direction. Now, remember, the best way to support your favorite podcasts, not just mine, but is to rate and review the shows in your favorite podcast app. It helps other people find it. It helps us know that we're doing a great job, or maybe if we need to improve on something. Either way, please rate and review your favorite podcast in your listening app. With that, have a great day.